Conjugate heat transfer is used to calculate convective heat transfer when the convection heat transfer coefficient is unknown. In this example, we will demonstrate how to use conjugate heat transfer, which couples heat transfer in solids and fluids with turbulent flow to cool a 200 degrees Celsius beam using 20 degrees Celsius air. After solving the model, we will analyze the temperature and velocity variations over time, up to 50 seconds. Before starting the modeling process, let's explain the geometry and physics involved. Conjugate heat transfer refers to the simultaneous analysis of heat transfer in both solid and fluid regions. It accounts for conduction in solids and convection in fluids, allowing for a more accurate and realistic prediction of thermal behavior in engineering systems. Conjugate heat transfer optimizes thermal performance across industries. It ensures reliability in aerospace and automotive systems, prevents overheating in electronics, enhances industrial heat exchanger efficiency, and enables precise heat control in energy systems like nuclear reactors and solar panels. In this example, I will simulate a beam section surrounded by air to analyze heat transfer. The beam temperature is initially 200 degrees Celsius, while the ambient air temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. The simulation uses a K-omega turbulence model for fluid flow and a time-dependent study to track temperature changes over time. The beam is made of structural steel, and the surrounding environment is air. In the results, we will analyze the temperature and velocity distribution around the beam. Additionally, we will visualize both temperature variations and flow arrows in a single plot to better understand the cooling process. With the explanation complete, let's begin modeling. I will start by clicking on Model Wizard. Since I want to model a beam in two dimensions, I will select 2D space. Next, I need to set up conjugate heat transfer so that I will expand the heat transfer section. Under conjugate heat transfer, I will expand the turbulent flow options and select the K-omega model, which is well suited for wall boundaries. I will then click Add and proceed to the study setup by clicking on the Study button. Since I want to cool a steel beam, I need a time-dependent solver to analyze the temperature changes during the cooling process. I will select Time-Dependent Study and click Done to finalize the setup. Since the beam's dimensions are small, changing the length unit from meters to centimeters is better. Next, I will add a beam from the COMSOL part library. To do this, I will navigate to the Geometry tab and click on Part Libraries. In the Structural Mechanics module, there are several types of beams available. I will expand the list and select the beam type I need. For this tutorial, I will choose the HEB beam and click Add to Geometry. Now, the beam is successfully added to the geometry. I will click on Build All Objects to generate the geometry in the graphics window. Since we need a surrounding domain for fluid flow, I will navigate to the Sketch tab and select Rectangle. I will start drawing from the edge of the beam and create a rectangular domain of optional size. Once the domain is created, I will adjust its dimensions in the size and shape section. For example, I will set it to 100 millimeters in 300 millimeters and then click Build All Objects. Next, we need to add an upstream domain for fluid flow. To do this, I will shift the X position by 100 millimeters. Now, the domain dimensions are properly set for this model. Let's move on to adding materials. I will right-click on Materials and select Add Material from Library. Depending on the model, we need air or water for the surrounding domain. In this example, I will select air by double-clicking on it. The beam material will be structural steel. After selecting the materials, I will close the window. Next, we need to assign the materials correctly. Structural steel is used for the beam, and air is used for the rectangular domain. I recommend unassigning the air material from the beam. Now the materials are correctly assigned. Let's adjust the heat transfer boundary conditions. The material error is due to the physics not being adjusted. First, let's assign solid and fluid domains in heat transfer physics. By default, all domains are considered solid, so I must manually assign the fluid domain. Since the rectangular domain represents the fluid, I will select it. As you can see, domain 1 is now overridden by the fluid. Now let's adjust the fluid flow physics. I will choose turbulent flow and deselect the beam domain since it is a solid. With this adjustment, the two physics interfaces are correctly assigned, and we only need to apply the boundary conditions. Next, I will click on materials to check the assignments. The red cross has disappeared, indicating that the air properties are now correctly applied to the fluid domain. The material content section displays the required properties for each model, showing which material properties are needed based on the selected physics and simulation settings. To define the boundary conditions, I will navigate to the Physics tab, expand boundaries, and select inlet. The inlet is on the left side of the domain, so I will choose it and specify a velocity of 2 meters per second. The other side serves as the outlet, so I will again navigate to the Physics tab, expand boundaries, and select outlet. I will choose these two edges as the outlet. The gauge pressure is set to 0 by default, corresponding to the ambient pressure, so I will leave it unchanged. Since the default fluid temperature is 293 kelvins, we must specify the temperature in heat transfer physics. First, I will assign a temperature to the inlet. To do this, I will expand boundaries in the Physics tab, select inflow, and choose the inlet boundary. I will set the fluid inlet temperature to 20 Celsius for this example. Next, we need to define the outlet temperature. Since the outlet temperature is unknown, I will select outflow and assign it to the outlet boundaries. This boundary condition will allow COMSOL to calculate the outflow temperature automatically. Since this is a time-dependent solution, defining proper initial values is crucial. As mentioned earlier, the fluid temperature is 20 Celsius, while the beam temperature is approximately 200 Celsius. I will copy the inflow temperature and paste it into initial values 1 to set the initial values. Pay attention to how the unit is written. The letter C should be capitalized. We also need a separate initial value for the beam temperature. I will navigate to the Physics tab, expand the domain section, and select initial values. Then, I will choose the beam domain and specify an initial temperature of 200 degrees Celsius. As you can see, the air temperature is set to 20 Celsius, while the beam temperature is 200 Celsius. Next, I will add a radiation heat transfer boundary to the beam surface. To do this, I will navigate to Boundaries in the Physics tab, select Surface to Ambient Radiation, and choose all outer surfaces of the beam except for the base. For this boundary condition, the emissivity of structural steel is approximately 0.3, and the ambient temperature is 20 Celsius. Conjugate heat transfer calculates only convection heat transfer. We can achieve a more accurate calculation of overall heat transfer by including radiation heat transfer. Let's take a look at the multiphysics section. I will navigate to non-isothermal flow in the multiphysics section and click on it. Here, we can see that the fluid flow is coupled with heat transfer, which helps cool the beam by reducing its temperature. No additional changes are needed. Next, I will navigate to Mesh 1 and click Build All. The default mesh size is generated and looks appropriate for this simulation. Now let's modify the output time settings. In step 1, I will click on the range button and set the simulation time to 50 seconds with a 2-second time step size. After entering these values, I will click Replace to update the settings. Everything is set up correctly, so let's solve the model. I will click Compute and wait for the solution to complete. During the computation, we can monitor the convergence plot. As you can see, the progress continues smoothly. Over time, the reciprocal of step time decreases, which increases the solution speed. Once the solution is complete, we can analyze the temperature distribution. The default temperature unit is Kelvin, so I will change it to Celsius and click Plot. As you can see, the temperature decreases over 50 seconds. At the time equal to 0 seconds, the temperature is 200 Celsius. We can observe how the temperature evolves at 2 seconds, 4 seconds, 6 seconds, and beyond, showing a gradual decrease over time. We can also check the velocity field. Initially, the velocity is 0, but it stabilizes after a few seconds. This plot displays both temperature and velocity of the fluid simultaneously. To explore different time steps, we can use the arrow buttons to navigate through the simulation results. Let's take another look at the mesh. The current mesh appears slightly coarse, so I will change the setting from normal to fine, click Build All, and solve the model again. After recomputing, we can observe a smoother temperature distribution in the downstream region. Additionally, the velocity field now appears with higher resolution. Sometimes the solution may diverge. In such cases, it is recommended to adjust certain settings to improve stability. One approach is to change the turbulence model and rerun the simulation, for example, by switching between K-epsilon, realizable K-epsilon, or K-omega to check which provides a more stable result. Another method is to modify the time-stepping settings and analyze the divergence plot to identify potential instabilities. We can find this option in the time-dependent solver. To apply it, simply check the box and enter the desired time to adjust the simulation settings accordingly. If the inlet velocity is too high, divergence may occur in the initial state, so adjusting the initial step can help stabilize the solution. This concludes the tutorial. If you found it helpful, please like and subscribe to my channel for more COMSOL tutorials.